Today, I'm going to talk about the use of cannabidiol, very popularly abbreviated CBD, as a possible treatment for schizophrenia or schizophrenia-related psychosis. I get asked quite a bit about CBD. It's an understandable question. If cannabidiol has little side effects or a substantially different side effect profile versus traditional antipsychotic drugs, which cannabidiol does have that significantly more benign side effect profile, and if CBD could be potentially helpful for schizophrenia, the question goes, can we use it? If so, what are the doses? And on and on. I would imagine that many of you have fielded similar questions. And it's, you know, for those reasons, the promise of something that might work that doesn't have the same side effect profile is very appealing. And CBD, as you all know, is very much in the news. As far as I see, CBD can do everything. It does everything good and nothing bad because of just the news reports that come across my screen every single day. That was obviously a bit of sarcasm, because if any chemical that is genuinely useful as a medicine is therefore genuinely able to alter physiology in a way substantial enough that it can counteract the effects of disease, and therefore any chemical with that kind of power to alter physiology in a significant way automatically will come with side effect risks. You just can't get something for nothing, as the saying goes. That said, the enthusiasm for CBD seems a bit overblown. Eventually, we will figure out what it's useful for and what it's not. And with that, I'd like to take a look at what we actually know about the potential value of CBD for schizophrenia. But before that, a preview on the hype. This is a PubMed search. I searched for cannabidiol and schizophrenia. 216 papers, articles are cited under that search strategy. But if you filter it to just clinical trials, you know, that in which CBD is given to investigate therapeutic benefit, you wind up from 216 down to 18. And if you go through each of those papers, as I did, you'll see literally only three studies in which CBD is compared to placebo for schizophrenia treatment. So I call this a noise signal or signal noise ratio of 1.4%. I believe this reflects that there's a lot of enthusiasm for CBD, but sadly not a lot of research on CBD for schizophrenia. Why did anybody get the idea of using CBD for schizophrenia? It's actually based upon some well-known effects of THC that THC causes psychosis. I think, as this audience knows, there's a long history of papers, epidemiological studies, which link cannabis use to the development of schizophrenia. On average, across about a dozen studies that have been done, you will see that the risk of schizophrenia is increased by a factor of about 4 in cannabis users compared to not cannabis users. Human laboratory studies in which you give THC to healthy human volunteers, by healthy I mean not currently with psychosis and generally no family history of mental illness, in those human laboratory studies, THC reliably induces psychosis, symptoms of psychosis, in a portion of those volunteers. CBD actually counteracts the psychotogenic effects of THC. And another of the adverse effects of THC is production of anxiety, and CBD relieves the anxiety associated with THC. So CBD seems to be a bit of a opposing chemical or a polar opposite to THC. And whereas THC causes psychosis in a fairly reliable way, at least amongst a subset of consumers, CBD works against that. So that's one piece of rationale for looking at CBD as a potential therapeutic agent. Another interesting argument is that CBD may increase the levels of anandamide. So let me tell you about anandamide and how CBD fits into that. There are these receptors in the brain called CB1. CB stands for cannabinoids. So these are the receptors that THC binds to and activates. THC functions as a partial agonist at these CB1 receptors, which are abundantly located in the brain, approximately a dozen brain regions, actually, I think more than that, but at least a dozen have dense populations of CB1 receptors that can be activated by THC. But of course, the body didn't make CB1 receptors to detect THC from cannabis plants. It has it to detect the signal from two chemicals, one of them called 2-acylglycerol, abbreviated as 2-AG, and the other one is called anandamide. So anandamide is one of the endogenous brain-produced natural agonists at CB1 receptors. Interestingly, anandamide is also a partial agonist at CB1 receptors in the brain. A couple of studies have shown that in people at the onset of psychosis, that those with higher levels of anandamide have less severe symptoms. So there's a significant inverse correlation between anandamide levels in the cerebrospinal fluid and the degree of symptom severity amongst people at early stages of psychotic illness. Keep in mind, again, high anandamide is associated with less severe symptoms. And as the aside, two studies, both involving human populations, both one by Levecki in 2007 and another one more recently by Morgan and colleagues in 2013, show that people who use cannabis frequently have lower levels of anandamide. And that might play into, obviously, why it seems to be related to the link between THC and psychosis or psychosis severity. Anandamide, like any kind of neurotransmitter or signaling molecule, there are processes in place to eliminate anandamide once it's been released so that the synapses aren't flooded with unnecessary anandamide. So similar to the enzyme acetylcholinesterase, which gets rid of acetylcholine by breaking it down, anandamide is metabolized by an enzyme that goes under the abbreviation FAAH for fatty acid amide hydrolase. And CBD is an inhibitor of this destructive or catabolic enzyme. So by inhibiting the enzyme that destroys excess anandamide, then CBD is in a position to possibly raise anandamide levels. And since higher anandamide levels correlate with less severe symptoms, it's actually a nice and compelling rationale for looking at CBD as a possible psychosis treatment. And now the data. I'm including case reports and case series just to give a complete representation of everything that we know from actual clinical experience. The first report to appear that suggested a benefit of CBD for schizophrenia came out of Brazil. They described a case of a 19-year-old woman who developed symptoms of schizophrenia at age 17. Although she did have successful resolution of her schizophrenia symptoms with Haldol, which I think is a key point when I summarize this, this woman had a treatment-responsive form of illness. But even though the Haldol could alleviate her psychosis symptoms, she had very obvious symptoms of hyperprolactinemia. She stopped menstruating, her breasts were producing milk, and she was gaining weight. And because of these, she stopped the medicine twice. And on both occasions of stopping the medicine, she had a recurrence of her symptoms of psychosis. At the second discontinuation-related relapse, the Dr. Zuardi and colleagues gave her cannabidiol, CBD, at a dose, importantly, of 1,500 milligrams, twice a total daily dose divided into two. So 750 milligrams twice daily, I would assume. And for 4 weeks, when CBD was the only medicine present, she had a nearly 70% reduction of her scores on the brief psychiatric rating scale, which is a very significant reduction. Unfortunately, the authors didn't tell us what her baseline was, but certainly it was severe enough to warrant inpatient hospital care. So she would have declined from a moderate to severe level of psychosis to 70% reduction. So this was a very good clinical response. I assume that they didn't have the wherewithal to give her CBD on an ongoing basis. So after 4 weeks, she was transitioned to Haldol, which sadly is a drug that she twice discontinued because of side effects. And she was returned to Haldol. Her BPRS scores didn't change. And then she was discharged. And eventually, as one might expect, she stopped the Haldol and then her symptoms returned. So main point, though, is that for 4 weeks, when CBD was the only drug present, she had a substantial 70% reduction of psychosis symptoms. Same group, Zuardi and colleagues from Brazil, then later reported the attempts to use CBD as a treatment for people who had treatment-resistant schizophrenia. So they describe three men, 22 or 23 years old, who met the definition of treatment resistance. They failed to have adequate response to two different adequately dosed and adequately long trials of antipsychotic medication. They offered each of these men CBD. They started at 40 milligrams per day, and then they had an escalating dose scheme so that they could wind up to a maximum of nearly 1300 milligrams a day. And the language of the case report is, you know, they betray an obvious optimism. They said, you know, slightly, I can't remember the actual language, but, you know, in the end, nobody improved. One said slightly better, one said not better, one said about the same, but got worse after the CBD was stopped. Altogether, there was no signal for any benefit. And so 3 out of 3 failures of CBD in treatment-resistant patient population. Well, a patient sample. Then came the most interesting and promising study of the lot. This came from Marcus Levecki in Germany. And they got 42 adults. They randomized them to CBD. The target was 800 milligrams a day. There was an option to reduce the dose to 600 milligrams a day if side effects arose. And they compared it to a very good and approved drug in Europe, amisulpiride, and just looked at PANSS, which is a positive and negative symptom scale, which is the standard, actually the most classic measurement of schizophrenia symptoms. And these are the results. The red line barely on the top is amisulpiride. The blue line is for CBD. CBD monotherapy is equivalent to amisulpiride. And I also want to point out, because it's relevant to the next study, look at the PANSS score. So they went out starting at, everybody started off at the baseline level. And by the end, both groups got to about a 30-point PANSS drop, which is, you know, a significant reduction. So CBD worked. And Levecki actually speculated a priori at the beginning of the study that there may be a relationship between CBD efficacy and anandamide levels. And so, in fact, they measured anandamide levels in the blood as this treatment went on, and the degree of therapeutic benefit from CBD corresponded to rises or to elevations in the levels of serum anandamide. So the hypothesis we explained earlier that maybe inhibition of fatty acid amide hydrolase by CBD would raise anandamide levels and that might translate into some benefit was borne out in this clinical study. So that was actually the only bright spot in my view on clinical research on CBD so far. Then we have this paper, which was quite interesting. As I pointed out, there are 216 publications that largely cheer on the idea of CBD as a treatment. And so, optimism and enthusiasm is high. The way that this paper was reported in medical media was astounding, because they were hailing it as a, you know, proof of concept that CBD works. It technically did, but in this study, first of all, patient population, these were individuals with partial response. So they had been on, they enrolled in the study while on antipsychotic medication, but had PANSS scores of about 80. So they were very symptomatic despite taking antipsychotic medication, or they were, you know, partial responders, if you put it optimistically. And they were given 1,000 milligrams a day versus placebo for 8 weeks, adjunctive to whatever medicine that they came in with. And what you get is you went from 80 to 72 or 80 to 68. So a average 10-point drop. Okay, go back to here. In this study, you had people go from baseline and they lost 30 PANSS points, or they gained 30 PANSS points in therapeutic gain. And in this study, you had an average of a 10-point reduction to PANSS score. So it was a relatively weak effect overall. And the difference between placebo and base and CBD group was statistically significant, but relatively small. Here at the end of treatment, so at the end of 8 weeks, this is the reduction from baseline in PANSS score for the placebo group. And this is the added benefit of the CBD group. Notice the standard deviation for the control. So to me, it's actually kind of amazing looking at this with naked eye that this actually came out to be statistically significant. 4 PANSS points it doesn't register to me as likely to be clinically significant. The authors did have the clinicians rate symptom severity based upon clinical global impression. And so there was, here we're looking at the placebo group at baseline to endpoint. So there was a small reduction in the placebo group of patients that were categorized as moderate, marked, or severely ill. And similarly, there was a reduction in proportions somewhat greater with CBD. So technically this worked, but it was a really small therapeutic gain. Then we had, in the same year, 2018, Boggs and colleagues came out with this study. They were primarily interested in the ability or the possibility that CBD might improve cognition. That's another benefit that's been suggested in clinical research. The patients in McGuire were chronically ill. McGuire and colleagues didn't tell us the average duration of illness. Boggs did. They were chronically ill people and with an average duration of 25 years of symptoms. Randomized to CBD 600 versus placebo, and primary outcome was cognitive score using the matrix cognitive battery. And interestingly, this red is the placebo group. Placebo group had some, we'll say maybe regression to the mean. They had a moderate gain in cognitive score over the course of 6 weeks. And the CBD group actually didn't gain numerically, they lost points. So you could spin this as saying that it had no effect or it worsened what would have been an expecting gain, but clearly not a cognition enhancing drug. And on the PANS, that measure of symptom severity, noting that the placebo group started from a higher level, they both ended at the same. So there was no benefit whatsoever of CBD on symptoms of schizophrenia and no benefit whatsoever on cognition. In fact, being on placebo was associated with a greater chance of some improvement. That's all the studies there are. So 216 reports or, you know, papers in the scientific literature to CBD and schizophrenia, this is the total published data. Very slim. If any like consumers at home are thinking about trying CBD for themselves and they wanted to match the dosing that was used in these studies, they're probably not going to be able to afford it on average. The 2020 average CBD price was 7.5 cents per milligram. Keep in mind, Levecki, which had the best response data, was using 800 milligrams per day. That translates into $60 for a single day's use or $1,800 per month. And the problem with getting CBD as a retail consumer is that there's really no quality control, or there's not consistent quality control across CBD products. Some might actually be pure CBD. Some might have contaminants from who knows what, and some will have CBD or other cannabinoids in them. And if one is to use these higher levels of dosing, then those minor ports, those minor components, like, you know, if it only had, say, 0.3% THC in the CBD preparation, that will at scale or at higher levels of consumption translate into a not insignificant amount of THC. So altogether, I don't see a whole lot of wisdom or value or, you know, ready for prime time use of CBD from retail sources as a treatment for schizophrenia. There's, you know, not really strong evidence that it works overall, although my analysis of these data lead to a couple of bright spots or ideas for future studies if anybody is planning on such things, and I'm sure that they are. It seems like people with early stage illness might have a higher likelihood of response. Certainly, it seems that people who are symptomatic despite adherence to antipsychotic drugs or who are frankly non-responsive are not going to be responding to CBD. And it seems, based upon Levecki's study from 2012, that to the extent that CBD might work, it might work best in people that are at early stages of illness and also that have lower anandamide levels in blood or CSF. And that's where we're at with the CBD story.